What's up, Crypto Knights? Derrick here again with another episode of the KTF News for you. It is Monday, June 4th, 2018. Welcome to the new week, and it's a pretty exciting news day in the world of cryptocurrency and tech at large, as Microsoft is going to acquire GitHub. They have not finalized the deal yet, from what I understand, but the news has gone out. News has been broken, and it has been confirmed that indeed Microsoft is going to acquire GitHub, which of course, as Bits Online is showing here in their article, it is the home of Bitcoin and blockchain code repositories. So GitHub, you're probably familiar with if you've ever looked over a specific project, read through their white paper, wanted to kind of dig into, you know, where their codes are, how many commits they've actually had, how much real code has been developed and put out there into the world. If you've ever looked into that before, then you've probably been on GitHub, because GitHub is the world's biggest and most popular open source software repository. There's over 20 million members and over 60 million different projects that host their code on the repository that is GitHub. Okay, so this is huge news, and it's huge news for everybody in the blockchain space, everybody that's into open source software, everybody that's into software development, period. And it's really big news that Microsoft would swoop in and just purchase a big company and website and community, really, that's so focused on the open source development community. And, you know, there's a couple of different reasons why that's a big deal. Of course, first off, there's going to be people, and you've already seen many people online probably talking about this, that, oh, you know, GitHub's finished now, Microsoft's the big bad bully, and, you know, they're going to take it and destroy it and all this kind of stuff. But I think we should look at the opposite angle of that. And the opposite angle of that is that Microsoft has consistently over the past couple of years been moving more into a direction where they're not focused on their own proprietary closed source software, but now being more interested in open source software development and being involved, of course, in the blockchain space as well, with the adoption of Microsoft Azure and the development and creation of blockchain as a service solutions for their customers and, you know, everybody out there that wants to try to use the Azure cloud-based solutions. So GitHub has been purchased, or again, not totally finalized yet, but ever since Satya Nadella, who is their CEO that took over in 2014, he's much more open source friendly. And, you know, the Microsoft team has been trying to get involved more with open source projects. And so the purchase of GitHub is a really big deal in the community, okay? And GitHub, of course, is massive, right? And it also acts as an open source community, or open source developer community, really. So it's not just a place where you can go and post your code and host your code for your projects. It's also a place where other developers will come and they'll comment on your code. You know, you can meet other developers, take part in open source projects that are open to the public to add commits on, all that kind of stuff. And it's really just become the go-to source for software development. And because of that, of course, it has become the go-to source for blockchain software development as well. So everything, you know, basically every blockchain-based project out there has a GitHub, right? They're posting their code and their commits on GitHub directly. So this is a big deal, not just for the greater tech space, but also specifically for the world of blockchain and cryptocurrencies. And now also, when we look at this, one of the other things that I want to address and to talk about, of course, is the fact that this is just basically confirming where the world of technology and software development is going, okay? We are moving more towards open source projects, and Microsoft knows that. So as I said, with the development of Microsoft Azure here, which of course you can take a look at here, is their blockchain as a service solution that they provide to a lot of different customers already, and they're working to be like the number one way for big companies or smaller companies to just get started using blockchain-based solutions in a really, really simple way, using the Azure cloud. So you can basically store your application on a blockchain in a cloud-based service, which makes it very easy to scale a lot more scalable than some of the other options that we've seen in the blockchain space so far. Now, on top of that, we've also recently seen Microsoft build its own custom Linux kernel for its new IoT service. And this just happened back in April. And I remember covering this story in our daily news, actually. So this is Azure Sphere, which is a new class of certified microcontrollers, or basically MCUs. And these are going to be used to control connectivity features on IoT devices, okay? So they're very, very small chips, very light chips. And of course, in order for that to work, Microsoft needed to look for something that was pretty low on the resource intensivity scale, if you will. And so they actually developed their own custom Linux kernel for this. So this just kind of goes to show you where Microsoft is heading. And, you know, Microsoft is, of course, one of the biggest and most influential technology companies of all time. They kind of helped build the modern world that we live in today. And so you can kind of take a look at what they're focused on now and where their vision is and kind of where they're moving going forward to get a good idea for where the rest of tech is headed as well. Okay. And so that's why this story is really, really big news. Okay. It's not just that Microsoft threw some of their hundreds of billions of dollars around to purchase a company that back in 2015 was valued at about $2 billion. Again, the deal has not been finalized yet, but both parties have confirmed that it is going to happen. We just haven't gotten any confirmation on the final terms of the deal. Of course, GitHub was looking to facilitate a private sale rather than try to do an IPO or go public or anything like that. So it looks like the GitHub team has gotten their wish and they will be purchased by Microsoft. And, you know, it's just kind of finalizing right now. So I think that's huge news for the space, for blockchain space, for open source technology. And I think finally, with the ability to easily incentivize open source development, you know, one of the biggest reasons we've seen open source projects not take off as much as the more closed source or privately developed projects is simply economics. There just isn't enough money in open source development, or there hasn't been enough money because basically they've relied on donations or just the time and labor and efforts of volunteer developers. And that's not really scalable, right? You need money, okay? You need economic resources to get your projects to the level you really want them to, especially if it's something big and revolutionary. And that's one of the most exciting and least talked about parts of cryptocurrencies and the blockchain and all this kind of stuff, is that we finally have a way to easily incentivize with, you know, real money, tokens, and all of that development. Okay. And since these are open source projects, people anywhere in the world can take part in them. And they'll be able to receive some tokens, or however it's going to work. Okay, there's different projects like DAO Stack, for example, that's really interesting. And DAO Stack is helping to create a framework for decentralized autonomous organizations, or DAOs. And through those DAOs, you know, the different participants can incentivize development work towards one task or another, and then people all over the world can participate and they can actually get paid out very easily for doing the work. Okay, so that's awesome. The open source community is the future. Blockchain-based projects are the future, where people all over the world, no matter who they are, where they are, whatever, if they have the skills and the knowledge and they want to put their heart and soul and effort into a project, they're going to be able to be compensated. And so seeing this kind of stuff move forward just gives me a lot more confidence, and just should kind of show you that even the biggest of the big dogs in the technology space and some of the oldest legacy computer technology companies are very quickly rising to the challenge of the new world that's in front of them. And they know that decentralized technology, blockchains, you know, the Tangle, all kinds of different solutions will obviously be there, but they know that the future definitely lies in open source software development through incentivization of participants all over the world. And that is awesome. And now speaking on that, I want to cover another awesome story for you today, which is about Ethereum. Okay. And Ethereum has been kind of forgotten recently with all the hype about EOS. A lot of people are saying, oh, EOS is going to kill Ethereum. Ethereum is just going to disappear. And, you know, oh, it's done for and all this kind of nonsense. First off, it is just that. It's total nonsense. I don't believe that for a second. Ethereum is a great project with a very, very deep, very passionate development community, lots of different people, lots of different stakeholders working on it. And it is the most decentralized blockchain that exists today. And we'll talk about that a little bit more in this story that I want to do. But the first part about it is Vitalik just recently spoke at explained in a recent Omisigo AMA session that Ethereum will eventually achieve 1 million transactions per second. And he said potentially more than 100 million transactions per second. Okay. And what he's saying is that, you know, scalability is a big issue right now. It's a struggle for the Ethereum network. They're aware it's a struggle. And, you know, it's being addressed through different issues. And so, of course, scalability is something that needs to happen sooner rather than later, hopefully, but it definitely needs to happen in order for us to take this whole blockchain thing to the mainstream, okay? In order for us to be able to run the next generation Facebook, the next generation Uber, whatever it is, right? You need to solve the scalability issues that we're having right now. But of course, there's a lot of different ways to do that, and there's pros and cons to each different way, okay? The more scalability that you have, the more security you have to give away, typically, okay? That's just kind of a generalization, but that's one of the issues that we're running into right now. So Vitalik says that, you know, scalability struggles, they're here, but with second layer solutions such as sharding and plasma, we will be able to see over 1 million transactions per second on the Ethereum blockchain. Okay, which would be absolutely incredible. So if you don't know what sharding specifically, what it does is it takes like every piece of the data and breaks it up into little individual parts. You could call those shards. And so each individual node doesn't need to process the entire collection of data. They're just processing one of those individual shards. You break it all up. All that kind of stuff makes it much easier, much more scalable. You also have Plasma, which is being built by Vitalik and also Joseph Poon, which is the Lightning Network co-author. And they are building out Plasma right now. It's supposed to launch this year with the start of the OMG project launching its own blockchain, which is a very exciting project in the Ethereum space to watch this year, as a lot of development is going on that as well. And so, you know, Plasma's coming, sharding's coming, the Casper protocol, which is the proof of stake protocol on Ethereum, is also coming. So there's a lot of really exciting stuff ahead for Ethereum. And now you may say, and some others have said that, well, they're too late because EOS is coming out and they're going to do whatever number of transactions per second. The reality is we just don't know yet, okay? Ethereum, or I should say EOS, also says that they can do very high transactions per second. We need to see it in the real world, okay? And I do, again, believe EOS is a great project and will do very well also. But it's different than Ethereum in many different ways. And so there are pros and cons to each. And so when EOS launches, which it's launching right now, you know, if we can see even 1,000 transactions per second, which is about what I think might be the max getting started, then that would still be fantastic. Okay, we've seen other blockchain projects do that number on their test net, but if we can see that consistently on a main net, then obviously at a transactions per second level, that's going to be much, much higher than where we're at right now on most of the different blockchains. You know, on average, Bitcoin's doing 3 to 4 transactions per second. Ethereum can do like 10 at the high end, 13 at the high end. But both of those blockchains are going to have second level or you know, layer 2 scaling solutions. And those are coming this year, which will definitely help the development of the blockchains. So Buterin basically said, Let me read his quote here. He said, the reason I think layer one and layer two networks are complementary is because ultimately, if you look at the math, the scalability gains from the layer one improvements and layer two improvements do ultimately multiply with each other. If you have a sharding solution, the sharding solution itself might increase the scalability of Ethereum by a factor of 100 or eventually even more. But then if you do Plasma on top of the scalability solution, then what that means is you're not just doing 100 times the amount of activity, but you're doing 100 times the amount of entrances, the amount of exits, and despite resolutions. So if you get a 100x from sharding and a 100x from Plasma, those two basically give you a 10,000x scalability gain, which basically means blockchains will be powerful enough to handle most applications most people are trying to do with them. And that's where Ethereum is working to get in this year. And you know, they're making a ton of progress. Now, also on that front with Ethereum, this is kind of the second part that I want to talk about and why there's a lot of benefits of Ethereum versus any other blockchain or development community that's out there right now, including EOS, okay? I'm excited about EOS and everybody's talking about EOS right now, but I just want to keep it kind of grounded here. There's a lot of hype, and with hype comes a lot of fabrications and a lot of people jumping to conclusions about just how much better EOS is than Ethereum. And there's a lot of things Ethereum's doing that it's gonna take a long time for EOS to get to this level, or they may never, okay? And that's the main thing that I wanna talk about, why Ethereum has such value. We're gonna talk about that right now. So the word Ethereum has been Googled more than 110 million times, okay? This comes from a recent blog that was put out by Consensus, which of course is one of the big production studios, big companies that builds different applications on the Ethereum network. And they recently put out a blog post called The State of Ethereum, just kind of trying to update us on where the Ethereum network is, where the community is, you know, how they're doing in the development, all that kind of stuff. And so this is awesome because it's got some great stats that I wanted to read out to you. So first off, the word Ethereum has been referenced in more than 110 million Google searches in the last 2 years. On average, hashtag Ethereum gets tweeted 20,000 times daily. Now, also really cool, the Ethereum network has processed about 240 million transactions. On January 4th, it set a record of 1.3 million transactions in a 24-hour period. You can see how the Ethereum transaction chart here has grown over the years. Now, here's the really cool part of what I just touched on briefly earlier. There's nearly 17,000 nodes operating the Ethereum blockchain on 6 continents, and that makes it the most decentralized blockchain platform. One sign of this, of course, is being 35 million. They have 35 million unique addresses on the Ethereum network now. The number of active addresses on January 4th for the first time exceeded 1 million and created a record of more than 350,000 new addresses in 24 hours. Of course, January 4th was right at the peak of hysteria in this past bull run that I know we're all wishing will come back very, very soon. But this is important, right? Because we're talking about EOS and how EOS is just going to crush Ethereum and all this. Basically, 21 block producers are going to kind of run the entire network and have ultimate say over the consensus. Yes, there's voting rights, and I don't want to just like completely dig into all the differences between Ethereum and EOS in this video. I think maybe do another video for that. But I just want to kind of point out the fact that Ethereum is really decentralized, okay? It's also the platform with the most smart contracts, okay? 94% of the top 100 tokens based on market cap are built on Ethereum, as are 87% of the top 800 tokens. So the tokens built on Ethereum are largely responsible for the $5.5 billion raised in 2017 token sales and nearly $10 billion raised so far in 2018. Pretty much all of them, not all, but again, 90 plus percent of the different ICOs that come out are being built on the ERC-20 standard. Now, also really, really important, and one of the reasons why you can't just say EOS is gonna come in and crush Ethereum. Ethereum has an estimated 250,000 developers, which represent the largest blockchain developer community. Truffle, an ETH development framework, exceeded 200,000 developments in October of 2017. And GitHub, which we just talked about, of course, cites 220,000 Ethereum commits and 14,000 repositories. The MetaMask browser extension that permits users to operate Ethereum dApps without operating a full Ethereum node has exceeded 1 million users. So over a million users on MetaMask now. Also, foundations, organizations, businesses, and startups have joined alliances to benefit from the Ethereum ecosystem, the most visible being the Ethereum Enterprise Alliance, and that's expanded to more than 500 members in 1 year. Okay, and there's different countries all over the world, Canada, Dubai, Switzerland, et cetera. Their governments, when the governments are working on building on top of blockchains, they're typically building on top of the Ethereum network. And also here, we've had over 1,500 dApps to date. So over 1,500 dApps have been created with more in development, lots more in development. There's numerous scalability projects. Of course, we talked about a couple of them with Plasma. And we're also looking at Cosmos and the Loom network, which is a very cool layer two platform that allows for social and gaming dApps to scale. All kinds of really awesome stuff. So I wanted to let you know about those two stories today. Some really big and exciting news with the Microsoft buying GitHub, and you know, just what that says about open source development and the future of the blockchain. So it's very exciting times. Let me know in the comments below, what do you think about Microsoft buying GitHub? Do you think it's good? Do you think it's bad? Do you think it's kind of whatever, not really a big deal? And tell me, like, what do you think it says? Do you think that kind of just goes to show that blockchain and open source technology is really the future, and that's just more confirmation of what we've all been talking about? Or do you disagree with that? And then let me know what you think about Ethereum as well. What do you think about Ethereum versus EOS? You know, do you think they can both coexist? Personally, I do. I think they will both coexist. I think they're going to be used for different things and by different people with different backgrounds that want different consensus methods and all that kind of stuff. But let me know what you think. Do you think Ethereum is done? Do you think it's over? Do you think, like, you know, EOS is, as soon as it gets launched, the next 36 to 48 hours here, it's just lights out for Ethereum? I don't know. Let me know what you think. Leave me a comment down below. And of course, go ahead and give it a thumbs up, maybe two thumbs up if YouTube will allow that for you today. And then definitely subscribe, because you don't want to miss any more videos that we upload here on the Keys of Freedom channel. So I will be back again with another update of some important news stories for you in the cryptocurrency space tomorrow. Peace.